Welcome to Energy Unplugged, your go-to podcast focusing on the global energy transition. My name is Olivier Beaufils, and I am ORA's head of US Central. Since the passage of the bipartisan infrastructure law and the Inflation Reduction Act, more than 2 years ago now, hydrogen in the US has become a strategic focus for many energy companies. One of the big questions facing the industry is what exactly counts as green hydrogen to qualify for tax credit. Last year, the IRS released their guidance on tax credits on Christmas Eve, triggering a wave of Christmas work holidays and complaints, as many considered them to be too restrictive. Close to a year later, it seems like a good moment to take stock of where things stand in the US hydrogen world. Where is the industry today? What has been the progress on the various hubs? And where do we go from there? On the podcast today is Brett Perlman, who has been running the Center for Houston Future for the last 7 years and is particularly involved in the development of the Houston Hydrogen Hub. Brett has a long and prestigious career in energy in the US, from consulting at McKinsey to serving as a commissioner of the Texas Public Utility Commission, where he oversaw the power market restructuring in Texas in the early 2000s. He has spent most of his career working on how to create the best competitive answers in emerging and evolving industries. And this seemed like the perfect set of experiences for him to tackle his current challenge, creating a low carbon hydrogen market in the US Gulf Coast. Brett, welcome to Energy Unplugged.
Thanks, Olivier. Thanks for having me.
So just to kick off, our listeners outside of the US might not be as familiar. So can you tell us a little bit more about the Center for Houston Future and your role there?
Yeah, I'm happy to. First, thank you for having me. And I'm very pleased to get a chance to talk a little bit about what we've been doing at the center over the last 5 or 6 years. As you mentioned, my career has been mostly in creating competitive energy markets. And so the center has really been focused on this idea of how do we create a global competitive clean hydrogen market along the Gulf Coast. So we do many things at the center, but thinking about the economic future of the Houston region is one of the primary things that we work on. And so this seemed like a project that was worthy of our time and attention.
And so with hydrogen, one of your main focus there, can you maybe explain a little bit more why the US Gulf Coast and Houston in particular is an attractive place to do hydrogen and to do clean hydrogen in particular?
So we're going to talk a little bit about clean hydrogen hubs, but the first thing to know about the US Gulf Coast is it already is a hydrogen hub, albeit one that has high CO2 and greenhouse gas emissions. We produce about a third of the nation's hydrogen on the Gulf Coast, primarily for the sole application of refining and petrochemicals. Later, I think we'll talk a little bit about hydrogen. We can expand hydrogen, but we really have the premier position, I think, in the US and globally to start this new industry of clean hydrogen based on the hydrogen we produce today. In addition to the amount of production, we have three major hydrogen pipelines that stretch along the Gulf Coast from Freeport all the way to Lake Charles. Three of the six storage caverns that exist for storing hydrogen, and really an industry that's very familiar with working with industrial gases, and both in terms of production and in terms of their uses. And so if you think about the US Gulf Coast and why we would want to work on this issue of decarbonizing our energy industry, there's no better place to start than with clean hydrogen, because as I mentioned before, while it is a potential tool in the toolbox for decarbonization today, it also emits a significant amount of the industrial greenhouse gas emissions in the greater Gulf Coast area. And so it's both an opportunity and a challenge to figure out how do we decarbonize this industry.
Absolutely. And so I would like to stop a little bit on this hub and the hub concept, right? As you say, the challenge with the clean hydrogen industry is being able to build the entire value chain from competitive supply and clean supply to transport and then offtake markets. Last year, the US Department of Energy, the DOE, awarded $1.2 billion to the High Velocity Hydrogen Hub in Houston. But before we start talking about supply demand, I think it's helpful to start maybe with a little bit of definition. What exactly is a hydrogen hub in this in the U.S. sense, and how do we approach it in Texas?
Let me even back up a step before that. When we started this down this road, the first thing we did is we tried to literally put the U.S. Gulf Coast, and we talk about hydrogen. I'm probably going to talk more about the Gulf Coast than I will about Houston, although Houston is the hub of the wheel. This infrastructure really, as I mentioned before, extends all the way from south of Houston to Freeport and as far as south as Corpus Christi into Louisiana. So we'll probably more talk a little bit about the Gulf Coast. But when we started this project, literally, we were not on the map. We would look at studies of demand in Europe published by, you know, very reputable organizations who are looking at how does Europe satisfy its need for hydrogen as a green hydrogen, in this case, as a decarbonization tool. And there was no thought that that Texas or the Gulf Coast could be a competitive market for that. And in fact, there was some skepticism really about whether energy companies in the Gulf Coast really bought into this idea of decarbonization. And so the first thing we had to do was we wrote a report, which is on our website, which laid out the business case for that. And we had over 100 stakeholders help us with that. It's a few years old now, but I think it's still the relevant document for the work we're doing in terms of laying out the vision for what we think the opportunity is. And then the next thing that came along was the bipartisan infrastructure law, which was one of two congressional acts that are funding the energy transition, the other being the IRA, and maybe talk about that in a little while. The bipartisan infrastructure law had $8 billion in it for the development of these hydrogen hubs. And the way they defined a hydrogen hub is that you have supply and demand in close proximity. And the reason for that, this whole idea of hubs, is because effectively, if we're going to use hydrogen, we have to build the market from scratch. There is no, in most parts of the country, and certainly around the globe, there is no infrastructure. That turns out, as I've explained, not to be true in Houston. In Houston, we already are a hub for the production of hydrogen. And so we took some of the companies that we had been working with and went out and along with our partners, GTI Energy and the University of Texas, we created a coalition basically to put a bid in for one of these hydrogen hubs that the EPA was looking for. And it was a very competitive process. There were 80 applications and ultimately 7 selections. And we were fortunate enough to be one of those hubs that were selected. And I'll talk in a minute about exactly what's in our hub. But that was really, I think, the spark that lit the flame, if you will, for what we're doing in terms of using hydrogen as a tool for decarbonization. But as you'll hear in a second, it's actually much broader than that. But to answer your question directly, a hub is the idea of linking supply and demand with connective infrastructure in such a way that you can start to develop a market around hydrogen, clean hydrogen.
And I guess the key question from there is, so how do you build the hub, right? So what are the key ingredients? How do you make this happen?
Yeah, the hub is in Texas, is in some ways, parts of it are already built because we have a lot of that infrastructure I was describing. Now, we need more of it and we need different kinds of infrastructure, but we're building on this base that we already have and then adding to that. So the way we thought about this is maybe somewhat differently than other parts of the country is, could we take energy projectors like large energy companies that were working on hydrogen, and could we push them together into our application? And so we have in our application, which we do call high velocity, and the high velocity is this idea of acceleration, of making the energy transition go faster. So we took projects that were already being contemplated, and that some of those projects are blue projects, some of those projects are green projects, some of those are transportation projects, some of them are energy storage projects, some of their pipeline projects. And we basically took what was already being worked on and combined it into a story, if you will, about how these 7 projects and 9, or 7 project developers and 9 projects could all combine into one very large clean hydrogen hub. And that's what we submitted to the Department of Energy. And so our role was not so much to develop the projects. We're not in a position to do, that's not our skill set. But our role was simply to bring together the parties that were already working on this and to connect the dots. And that's a good thing that we do quite a bit at the center. We see sometimes pieces of the puzzle that others don't see quite as early, and we link them together in a way that has impact for our community. And so that's effectively what we did in our hydrogen hub application.
That's a point I just want to stop on for a second, right? Because I think that's an interesting thing for a listener to understand. So in Texas, we don't really like central planning. I don't think this is something we do very much. And so in this case, it's definitely more of a coordination effort, linking private initiatives from all these developers that we're seeing potential and then pulling it all together, as opposed to maybe the way the California hub came about. And I don't know if you want to comment on the difference in philosophy there.
And this gets back to why I wanted to do this. When we were 20 years ago, when we were creating the restructured electric market, effectively what we had is a coordination challenge. How do you bring all of these separate integrated utilities together and basically create a competitive market out of it? And that took a lot of restructuring of the utilities itself, but it also took the creation of a competitive framework. And that coordination function is effectively what we did at the commission. And same thing here, we already had a lot of these projects underway across the Gulf Coast. And all we simply did is put together the story and look for the synergies between the various projects that are going on. The seven project developers that we have in the hub are just representative, however, of a much bigger market, which we'll talk about in a second. But it's just the first phase of what we expect to be a much larger hydrogen ecosystem, which I think is in some ways the bigger picture story than the DOE grant, is about how competitive markets are making this happen. In California, and we work a lot with our colleagues in California and have done that. I've done that for over 20 years. Because as you remember, or some of you remember, old enough to remember, California was ahead of Texas in deregulating their energy market, and it didn't go so well for them 20 years ago. And so we learned from that experience when we restructured our electric market, hopefully did it a little bit better. Of course, we've made some of our own mistakes. Texas and California are always pointed to as the two different philosophies in the way that government works in energy policy. However, I think there are more nuances than that, because we can learn from each other's mistakes in how to create these markets. And so California, in terms of its hub application, which is called ARCHES, took a much more of a top-down approach in terms of the state organized the hub. The governor's office really put together separate competing entities into one application, whereas ours was more bottoms up. It arose from the projects that were always already developing. In some ways, California, I think, is ahead of us. In some ways, we're ahead of them, both in terms of the development of these clean hydrogen hubs. And it just has to do with the ways that our economies work differently and the philosophies are somewhat different, even though we're all heading towards the same ultimate outcome.
And I think something interesting for Europeans or Asian companies and people involved in hydrogen to learn as well, just different examples of how this is done. I want to move a little bit towards actually talking about supply and demand in the Gulf Coast. So can you maybe walk us through just what kind of supply really Houston is looking at? And we know there's a lot of what's called gray hydrogen, right? The traditional hydrogen, but from a low carbon standpoint, what kind of supply? And then what kind of key demand centers or demand industries are you looking at?
This is why I spent a minute talking about the report we wrote, because the report we wrote really crystallized what the market opportunity is in the Gulf Coast. We produce today about 3.2 million tons of hydrogen out of 10 million tons that are produced in the U.S. And so it's about a third of the hydrogen produced. When we looked at this, and with the help of McKinsey and some of the stakeholders that actually worked on this project, we reconceptualized that as being as large as 21 million tons by 2050. How do you get from 3.2 million tons of gray hydrogen a year to 21 million tons of clean hydrogen in less than 20 years? you need to have a new approach to doing this. And it has to be one that will scale as well as one that is innovative. And in our market, we have both blue, what people call blue projects, which are traditional natural gas produced hydrogen, as well as green projects. And I didn't mention, but I will now, just for a point of emphasis, is that Texas ERCOT, our power market, is the largest renewables market in the country and one of the largest in the world. And so the opportunity to use both traditional ways of making hydrogen, but adding capturing the carbon, as well as looking at newer technologies, or not some new technologies, but more different technologies, splitting water into hydrogen and oxygen using renewables, all those energy resources exist in the Gulf Coast. And so we really have this broad supply of blue and green. Now, I think it's interesting to see how this has evolved, because when we started, there was some skepticism, and probably still is, about blue hydrogen and whether it can be a tool in decarbonization. I think what we're starting to see is those projects, which are blue projects, are going to scale much quicker than the green projects because they build on existing infrastructure. And they're also going to be very low carbon because they're going to use feedstocks, which have been decarbonized. And in essence, you can have your cake and eat it too. You can have a natural gas-based clean hydrogen system that starts today and scales at the same time that you're developing these newer technologies. And I think the most interesting thing to me is when we talk about supply of hydrogen, we may not know today what the real winner is in terms of what the ultimate supply will be. And I think that's particularly true because innovation is going to play such a big role in this market. And we're starting to see that happen in lots of different ways. And so I think that's what we're trying to do. We're not trying to pick a particular pathway. We're trying to basically make it economically attractive for developers to develop projects and then to decrease the cost in order to make margins. That's the secret of the competitive market that we have that we're trying to create here in the Gulf Coast.
Yeah, that's really interesting, right? Because the big difference, as you've been mentioning, is you can anchor to existing infrastructure, existing supply, existing demand, right? So you have a big pull to get started. And so those traditional demands, refining, petrochemicals, in particular, ammonia and methanol production are huge markets to tackle. What about the new sources of demand? What's your take on people that look to hydrogen for transportation or for power generation, for instance?
Yeah, I think one of the things that we saw in the work that we did is that there will be multiple applications, both the traditional ones that you mentioned, which are how hydrogen is used today. Hydrogen is used as a feedstock in refining and petrochemicals, and we need to switch from gray to blue or green in order to decarbonize that industry. But there are, and ammonia is an existing industry, and fertilizers, and will be an industry in transportation, because ammonia happens to be a good vehicle, an efficient vehicle for transporting hydrogen long distances. And so we do have a number of these traditional markets, but then we do have the newer markets, which you mentioned as well, which don't exist today, but which are going to be key to decarbonizing our energy infrastructure. And just to take transportation as an example, we have in the Houston, basically a huge container port, the seventh largest in the country, that has 10,000 truck runs a day coming in and out of the port. And those trucks all are today are diesel trucks and emit quite a bit of particulate matter and ozone. And so here is a perfect example for replacing that heavy-duty trucking fleet with cleaner hydrogen generated by fuel cells. By the way, that could be also generated by internal combustion engines, and some people have been thinking about that. So again, we don't know quite what the technology winner is, but both could be low-carbon solutions. And applications like trucking fit really well with the ecosystem we have because they're part of what we do as an economy. We're also working with our airport system, with Airbus and Chevron, to create new opportunities for things like hydrogen and aviation. And while the first applications may be in things like buses and ground transportation, ultimately, we're envisioning that we will have hydrogen-fueled airplanes. And in fact, I don't think that world is as far off as some people might think. And so hydrogen has applications there as well. It also has applications in what people call the hard-to-abate industries, such as steel and cement. And so really, hydrogen is that Swiss Army knife, as Bill Gates once called it, of tool for decarbonizing our energy system. And I think all those examples of applications exist in miniature along the Gulf Coast.
So there's another one that people are talking a lot about in the Gulf Coast, which is potentially exports, right? We're a region that's been just supplying a lot of energy to the world, right? Obviously, oil and natural gas historically. But what about hydrogen exports? What do you make of that? Are we going to export hydrogen just like we're exporting natural gas?
Again, the historical perspective is, I think, useful here because people forget some of this history. 25 years ago, we thought that the U.S. was going to be an importer of natural gas. And in fact, this was pre-fracking revolution, and fracking has become a political football. But if you think about how it's transformed the energy industry, it completely transformed the Texas landscape in particular and the U.S. landscape around natural gas, because when we originally thought we were going to need to be a net importer of natural gas, it turned out technology turned us into a net exporter. And those terminals that were being created for import were turned right around after a couple of years, not without some economic turmoil for developers who were building import facilities to create export facilities. And so now, 20 years later, the U.S. Gulf Coast has so much natural gas, it can't figure out what to do with it all. Frankly, and is producing so much of it has now become a problem. I think there's some potential analogies to hydrogen. Today, we have the opportunity to use hydrogen in the same way that we're dealing with liquefied natural gas as a fuel, basically for those parts of the world which don't have their own energy resources. And we've been exploring this idea. This will take, again, another long time for this industry to emerge, because we have to build basically the supply chain for exports. But we're starting today on that. And in fact, we're taking a delegation at the end of October of this year to Japan and Korea to talk to Japanese and Korean companies about how we work together on this journey of using hydrogen as an energy carrier. That could be in the form of ammonia, as we discussed before, or liquid, what are called LOHCs, liquid oxygen organic hydrogen carriers, or perhaps some other technologies that have yet to be taken out of the lab. And so I think there's a real opportunity for thinking about this in the same out of the natural gas playbook, in some ways out of the LNG playbook, in terms of how we create an industry, because we've done this before in the recent history of the energy industry. And so I'm very excited about the opportunity, not only to supply our own needs domestically, but also to think about how we can become a global leader in decarbonizing energy systems around the world.
Definitely a lot to follow there in terms of how all of this is going to evolve. I wanted to switch maybe a little bit to the tax credits and incentives that have been put in place. There were a lot of intense reaction in the industry last year when the IRS released their hydrogen tax credit guidance. As you very well know, where the three different pillars, additionality, deliverability, and hourly matching. I think the first two in Texas are relatively straightforward. We're developing a lot of renewable projects, and so finding new projects to associate to is not too complicated. The deliverability with an ERCOT is relatively straightforward as well. But the hourly matching is something that made a lot of people quite upset because it was considered too stringent, or probably still is. How do you think that has affected the industry? How do you think about hourly matching in the context of this development?
Let's even back up a step and talk about why we have these requirements. And I think it comes out of a set of shared objectives, but maybe a disagreement around timing. We definitely believe that if we're going to when our energy system is still very much carbon, has a lot of carbon intensity, I think it's appropriate to think about making sure that the energy that supplies hydrogen can be less intense, less carbon intense than the power that's coming off the grid. And so this idea of making sure that you get your power generation, particularly for a hydrogen produced by electrolysis, which is really what we're mostly talking about here, that we can make sure that, and from an accounting standpoint, that the hydrogen we're producing comes from low cost sources of electricity. And so hourly matching is nothing more than an accounting principle to make sure that the source of the electrons that are creating the molecules are clean. That's really all it is. The issue becomes that it's not that easy to do that in, as a practical matter. There's technology involved on both sides, on the electric side and on the hydrogen production side, that doesn't exist today. There's some complexities, and because of the way the energy is produced and transmitted, we don't necessarily consume electrons that are colored green. We consume grid power in many cases. And how do we account for those, that power we're using? And that's actually this quest for making sure that the power is absolutely the cleanest it could be has actually pushed us probably in some ways, in addition to hourly matching or because of hourly matching, that may be counterproductive, such as putting all of the renewables behind the fence, which may be the solution in some markets. But when you have 35 gigawatts of wind power on your system and another 100 gigawatts that you would hope to build over some period of time, or developers who are willing to build those 100 gigawatts of renewables, it seems a little counterproductive to require all that electricity to be behind the meter. And I think this whole idea of hourly matching has gotten out of hand in a way, because it's causing people to make some decisions that they probably wouldn't make economically, particularly in a market like Texas, which has a lot of renewables. And so I think the problem is both a technical one, in the sense that it will be very difficult to have the technology. It's an accounting one, and how do you count? And it's an economic one, in the sense that it's causing some decisions which are not necessarily grounded in economics.
On this side, and the impact on the electric sector, I think this is a very important point that I'd like to take a little bit further, right? As you say, there's two parts to that. One part is the supply of electricity, and we want to make sure that's green for electrolyzers. And so that involves building gigawatts and gigawatts of renewables. On the other side, we're going to need a lot of electrolyzer capacity to make the green hydrogen in addition to the blue. And that represents a lot of capacity to be added to the system. So how do you think about this interaction between power and hydrogen in the context of the Gulf Coast, and in particular the ERCOT market that a lot of people are familiar about?
When DOE started developing these ideas of clean hydrogen markets, they talked a lot about sector coupling. And the idea of hydrogen is it's that wonderful thing that can basically create the connections between power and natural gas and industrial applications. So this idea of coupling the entire energy sector is one that we talk about a lot in our work and is a very interesting idea to play with. But the downside of it, of course, is that in order to couple the sectors, you have to build the resources. And particularly with electrolysis, which is relative, takes a lot of electricity, it will require the development of a fleet of new solar and wind plants in order to serve that market. And those wind plants and solar plants don't just emerge, they have to be connected to the grid. And in order for us to create this vision of a large decarbonized hydrogen, clean hydrogen ecosystem, we're also going to have to create a much bigger grid. And that's why these two industries, industrial gases and power, have to grow together. Because if we don't have the power to run the plants that are going to produce all this hydrogen, then this is just not going to work. And so we are actually working. It puts me back in my days 20 years ago as a PUC commissioner, because we need to put the right set of incentives in place in order to reform the power markets to support these emerging hydrogen markets.
So we talk a lot about that, the need for the power system to be there to supply the electrons for the electrolyzers. But Can you maybe help us understand also maybe the services that electrolyzers can provide to the grid, right? It might be a little bit of a two-way street in some ways.
No, absolutely. Again, these things have nuances and complications that people don't think about, it because you think about building gigawatts and gigawatts of power and then the transmission to support it. That's going to cost a lot of money. But the interesting thing about hydrogen is it has lots of capacities that the grid needs. It can start, and it's particularly the newer types of electrolyte, which are called PEM, proton exchange membrane electrolyzers, effectively are no different than a small generation plant. They're just on the opposite side of their load. So they can ramp up and ramp down very quickly and provide grid services so that you can match supply and demand in real time. And they provide a form of, can provide energy storage as well in terms of storing hydrogen and then using it on peak. And so if we rethink the way our power system works and think about loads as a resource, which is something I've been working on for 20 years, by the way, in terms of thinking about demand response as well as loads as providing energy, then hydrogen is well equipped to meet the needs of our power system of the future. It just takes a complete rethinking of how energy resources work in our power grid. It's not just about generating an electron and putting it out there so that it perfectly matches supply, which we've done now for over 100 years perfectly, but it's rethinking the opportunity for loads to play a role in the energy system. And this kind of thinking is difficult, sometimes difficult for people to get their heads around, particularly engineers that have been involved in power systems for most of their career. And so a lot of what we're doing at the center is trying to get people to rethink how power systems work.
It's quite a fascinating industry. And as you mentioned, I think flexibility is becoming the name of the game, right? It's not just the intermittency on the supply side, but it's also the flexibility on the demand side that's becoming key. Maybe a last question to wrap up, Brett. What would you respond to people that are saying that hype, we had the big hype wave, just like we had for other industries, and we're now over it? Where do you think this market's going?
I think like a lot of technology industries, they're subject to something that's called the hype cycle. It's not unique to hydrogen for sure. We're seeing it in AI. We've seen it in all kinds of industries, in telecommunications and even in PCs 20 years ago. This idea that markets, basically, when they're new, people get excited about them, have all kinds of ideas, and then the reality sets in, and there's some disillusionment. And I think we're in that valley of disillusionment right now with hydrogen. Whereas a couple of years ago, people thought this was the next best thing, and then it became clear how hard this is and how long it's going to take. And oh, by the way, maybe those tax credits weren't quite as good as everybody thought they were. They have all these restrictions on them. And so we're in that valley of disillusionment. But what comes out of that is the plateau of reality. And so I think that's where we're headed with hydrogen. It's existed for a long time. We know we can do it. We have to just figure out what is its place in the energy transition. And that's where I think we're headed to in Texas and with the work we do.
I think that's a great place to wrap up. Brett, thank you so much for your time and your insights today.
Great to have a conversation with you, Olivier. And thank you for all the work you do in this industry. You've been a great friend and partner over many years.
That was Olivier Beaufils, Aurora's head of US Central, talking to Brett Perlman, CEO of the Center for Houston's Future. Thanks for listening to Energy Unplugged. Do keep an eye on our podcast feed for more in-depth conversations with senior members of the energy industry. The best way to do this is to follow or subscribe to the podcast via whatever platform you use.